Hello, Georgetown. I'm Beverly Enos, and this is Spotlight Georgetown. You can find us Fridays, Saturdays, and Sundays on your local cable television station, whether it be Comcast, Verizon, whatever you have. Now, part of this project is for the community. If you would like to learn how to run the cameras or do some editing, be in the hot seat here, if you would like to volunteer somebody else to be in the hot seat, we'd love to have you let us know, and we'll make sure that you become part of this and you get to come down here and play with all the fancy equipment that they have. And they have recently gotten some new equipment that they're having fun with, so come down and join us. Now today we're going to be talking to Diane DiNapoli, and she is fondly known as the Penguin Lady. So welcome.
Thank you for having me.
It's nice to have you here.
Thanks.
Now how long have you been here in town?
I've been here for 9 years now.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. Because I haven't heard of you before, so...
No, I kept a low profile, I guess.
All of a sudden. You have family here with you, or...?
My partner, Mark.
Yeah. And you're from this area to start with?
I grew up in Marblehead, so... And my dad still lives down in Marblehead. My brother actually lives two miles down the street in Groveland.
So you are a Massachusetts native.
I am.
How did you come to be known as the Penguin Lady?
It was a long, circuitous route to getting there. I actually was obsessed with dolphins when I was little. And I finally, at the age of 32, decided to return to school so I could apply for an internship to work with dolphins. And in the course of my schooling, I had an internship at the New England Aquarium in Boston. And I actually started working there after I graduated from college. And when people would come into the building, they'd see me in the exhibit in a wetsuit up to my neck in cold water, surrounded by 70 penguins, and they'd say, look, it's a Penguin Lady. And okay. So that name just stuck.
That sounds like a great job. I'd love that.
It was a really cool job. A lot of fun.
That would be a lot of fun. Penguins are great. As I told you earlier, I have been snorkeling with them in Galapagos, and they're funny.
They are, aren't they?
They're just funny little things.
Yeah, they're very curious, very interested in you.
It's like they're all hyped up on something or other. They're all bouncing around all over the place. How long did you work at the aquarium?
I was there for 9 years. So I was an intern for 2 years, and then I was hired in 1997 and worked there for 7.5 years.
What was the best part?
I think just getting to know each individual bird. Because what I didn't realize before working with penguins, you know, you see these large flocks and colonies of birds and penguins, and you think, oh, they're all kind of the same. But what I really discovered was that each animal had a very unique personality and temperament, and some liked you and some didn't, and for no reason that you knew of, but you just developed individual relationships with each bird, which I really enjoyed.
Like you would with dogs or cats?
Yeah. In fact, I often compare them to cats because they seem to have a similar level of intelligence, and they know their names, and so when you'd call them, if they...
Really?
They do, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
They know their names, and if you called them and they felt like coming over, they would, and if they didn't, they just sort of look at you over their shoulder and swim away in the other direction, much like a cat might
do. Much like a cat would be. Tell us something about penguins that most people wouldn't know, other than they can be called by name.
Well, you know, I think the number one question is, do penguins have knees?
And the
knees. Okay. Because they look like legless wonders. They actually do have knees. And also that they're not really cute and cuddly. A lot of people think, oh, they're so adorable. And they are. They're cute. But they actually are very ornery, and they have incredibly sharp beaks. And they really are very prone to biting. And it really, really hurts. It draws blood and leaves a welt and a bruise.
So they're not necessarily the little cute things that you see on March of the Penguins.
Not quite, no.
Now, you have a book. Mm-hmm. You just published a book.
Yes, I did.
And it is The Great Penguin Rescue.
What is that about? The Great Penguin Rescue is about the remarkable rescue of 40,000 penguins from the Treasure oil spill in South Africa. And I had the great privilege of working as a supervisor to help train and manage more than 12,500 volunteers who came from all over the world to help save the penguins.
With the last oil spill that we had, the minute I saw the photographs on TV with the birds, with the oil, I had to turn it off.
Yeah.
Can't look at it.
Yeah.
What happens, let's go back to this one first. There are penguins in Africa. That just doesn't sound... It doesn't sound right.
I know. It's something that most people have no idea that penguins, number one, live in Africa, number two, live where it's warm at all. African penguins are the only penguins found on the African continent. They are in South Africa and Namibia. And actually, most penguin species do not live where it's really cold. They actually range from the equator, where the Galapagos penguin is, mm-hmm. which you swim with, all the way down to Antarctica and everywhere in between. So they do actually live in warm climates, many of them.
The thing that surprised me about Galapagos is it's freezing. The water is freezing. Yeah. But the Humboldt current that's coming up from Antarctica.
Right.
And the water is literally freezing. You have to do full scuba gear, gloves, feet, everything. It's warm and sunny out,
right,
but the water is really cold.
Yeah, so. I wore two thin wetsuits when I dove there, when I swam there as well, because it was so cold. Yeah. And that cold water current, though, is why the Galapagos penguins can live there, because the fish come in those cold water currents.
And that is their feeding grounds.
Exactly.
Okay, that answers another question. Mm-hmm. What happens, we'll go back to the oil spill, what happens to a penguin when it gets covered with oil?
First, at sea, when it gets covered with oil, it what happens is that oil is so thick and viscous, it clumps up and separates their feathers. And their feathers are what form this impervious shield to keep the cold water from getting down to their skin. And so first what happens is that cold water gets down to their skin and they become hypothermic, they get too cold. And they also can get waterlogged and drown. And so they'll head for land immediately, and as long as they make it to land, they'll haul out and stand there, but they won't go back to sea to hunt for food because it's too cold, so they can starve. And then what they'll do is they'll start to preen, and they use their beak to straighten out their feathers. And they're trying to get this oil off, which they can't. And they're inadvertently ingesting or swallowing that oil while they're preening. And then that starts to cause a whole host of other problems like anemia, dehydration, bleeding ulcers. So it's all bad.
Yeah, it's not a pretty sight.
No.
How do you clean the birds?
It's a very labor-intensive process. It would take 4 days to train a volunteer when we were in South Africa how to do this. It takes two people, one person to hold or restrain this penguin who's fighting you, and another person to do the cleaning. And so you would take the penguin and dip it in a vat of hot water that had dishwashing soap in it and agitate the feathers, and then until that tub ran black, and you would go from pool tub to tub to tub of hot soapy water until the water ran clear, which sometimes could be 10 or 15 washes. And then you have to rinse them with a high pressure hose to get the residual soap off their feathers. Because even if that soap is still on there, they won't be able to waterproof their own feathers again to go back out to sea.
So what is the life expectancy once you save, if you catch it early enough for the penguin?
Actually, it can be the same as their never oiled counterparts.
Okay.
Yeah. So penguins do very, very well. They can handle the stress of the handling, which some birds can't. And they're so hardy that once you rehabilitate them and get them back out in the wild, they'll live just as long as other penguins.
They'll be fine. Mm-hmm. What's the average size for a penguin?
They do range. The smallest is a little blue, and we had those at the New England Aquarium, which are just 2 pounds and about 8 inches high, when they're really cute. And the largest is the emperor penguin, which is 3.5 to 4 feet tall and can weigh up to 95 pounds. But most penguins are about 21, 22 inches high and weigh between 8 and 12 pounds.
Okay. Mm. All right. That's, I think, what most people expect. But the emperor penguins are really solid.
Yes. Yeah, they're the largest and the hardiest.
And those are the ones that you see most in advertisements and
March of the Penguins.
March of the Penguins.
That wonderful documentary.
Yeah. When we talk about saving the animals from the oil spills, is it really worth all that work? I mean, how many thousands of people that you train?
12,500 who had no experience working with penguins whatsoever.
And it's worth 12,500 people for donating all that time.
It really, really is. You know, during the BP oil spill in the Gulf, there was a German biologist, Sylvia Gauss, who was quoted saying that it's, you know, you saw these horrible images of birds that were, they looked like they were coated in chocolate. They were so heavily oiled. And she was quoted as saying, you know, it's just not worth the effort because only 1% of these birds will survive after being rehabilitated and released. But that was not right. That was inaccurate information. It's really important that people understand that it's really valid and worthwhile because we save 95% of those birds. And they're back out on their breeding islands and you know, raising the next generations of penguins. So even if it's, you know, a few birds, it's the right thing to do is to save an animal in distress.
Yeah. 95%. That's a high percentage.
It's huge. Yeah.
Did you go down there?
To the Gulf. You know, I was actually scheduled to go down for a month. The same people that I was working with in South Africa, Jay Holcomb from the IBRRC, the International Bird Rescue and Research Center based in California, they were running the effort down in South Africa. And he also was down in the Gulf, and I was supposed to go. And then a few days before I was leaving, the information started coming out about the Corexit, the the dispersant that was being used and how incredibly toxic it was, and how many of the frontline workers after the Exxon Valdez, when they had used the same dispersant 20 years later, were dead or had chronic lung problems, chronic kidney problems. And I was born with one kidney, and so I like to keep it.
Yeah.
You know, so I made it was a very excruciating decision because I wanted to go, but I decided my health had to come first.
Now, you're talking about this is a chemical that was put into the water to disperse the oil.
Exactly.
So that it wouldn't sit there clumping on top of the water.
Right, which actually is sort of counterproductive, because once it disperses and breaks up into little tiny pieces and goes down into the water column, they can no longer collect it, and then
yeah.
it gets into the food chain. And so that's what's happening now in the Gulf. There are these huge 20-mile-long streams of dispersed oil about a mile below the surface.
Wouldn't it be easier to just catch it all at once in the top?
It would, okay. Yeah, yeah.
We weren't running that rescue
no,
service,
we weren't.
Obviously.
No.
The penguins in South Africa, how are they doing now?
You know, we had this amazing success rate, which was remarkable, and it's only due to all of those volunteers. Sadly, their population now is half of what it was when we left South Africa 10 years ago. And it's not because of the impact of the oil spill, it's because of starvation. And so what's happening now is they're being affected by global warming, which is moving their food mm-hmm. too far away from where they are because of the shift of the cold
yeah.
water currents, and overfishing, because we're really overfishing our oceans to a great extent.
So if they don't have enough of their food in the food chain,
they're going to starve.
They're yeah. going to starve.
Yeah.
What is happening with some of the other penguin species?
There are 18 penguin species, and 14 of those 18 species have recently been declared either threatened or endangered. And
Ooh.
So, yeah, it's a huge problem. Their populations, most have declined by 90% in the last 100 years, and that's a very precipitous decline. And why this is so important is because penguins are an indicator species. So they're the proverbial canary in the coal mine. And so when we see their populations, you know, when they're dying, it means our oceans are dying. And ultimately, you know, that's going to affect us as well. So we really have to start looking at what's happening with these animals and change our behaviors to help protect them in the oceans.
What can people do? Change their behavior.
Yeah. If people want to do something directly to save penguins, I contribute 20% of every appearance I make, and from proceeds from the book as well, to penguin rescue groups. And there is an extensive list of penguin rescue research and conservation groups in the appendix of the book that people can donate to. And then just in a broader sense to help penguins and all animals in our oceans is just to reduce our reliance on fossil fuels, to reduce our carbon footprint. You know, you can go online to calculate your carbon footprint. And
really?
Yeah, yeah, there's a lot. Carbonfootprint.com, I think, is one of the online calculators. And it's very enlightening exercise. You might be surprised when you see how much carbon you as an individual are putting out there. And so just little things like turning down the thermostat, you know, carpooling to work if you can, getting
any type
hybrid,
of energy conversation.
Any kind of, yes.
Energy
conservation. Exactly. Yeah.
yeah.
Will help the animals. Yeah.
Okay. What if someone wants to get involved in something like this either as a volunteer
mm-hmm.
or as a career?
Mm-hmm. I think the most important thing is, you know, if you're a young student and you're interested in working with animals, is to study the sciences, which I didn't know when I was young. I wish someone had sort of told me when I was younger. So, you know, pay attention to your science class. You want to study biology, marine biology, ethology, which is animal behavior. But it's very important to start volunteering or getting an internship at a zoo or an aquarium so you get that hands-on experience. Mm-hmm. And if you're not near a zoo or an aquarium, maybe volunteer at a shelter or an animal hospital. But it's important to know that working with wildlife is really dirty, messy, smelly work. It's not glamorous in the least. So it's good to find out first, you know, maybe volunteer before you go to college for that and find out if that's really for you or not.
Now you have the book.
I do.
And this has just been put out.
It's just been put out, yep. It was published on October 26th by Simon & Schuster Free Press imprint.
And this is about the rescue in Africa.
It is. This book is about the rescue effort. It has a little bit of my background, a little bit of my work at the New England Aquarium, and then it takes the reader through the entire oil spill, what happened to the ship, the rescue of the animals, the recovery process, and releasing them back out into the wild, and then a follow-up 10 years later of how they're doing.
Now, other than writing the book, mm-hmm. do you work? Do we have another job?
Yeah, when you're writing a book, you don't have time for another job.
No, you don't.
But I, as the penguin lady, that is my business. And so when I left the aquarium 6 years ago, I started the company. And what I do is I travel locally and internationally, and I teach both children and adults about penguin biology of behavior and conservation. And I've been on cruise ships, and I go to schools and colleges and libraries and museums. And it's really rewarding to get to share some of these stories with people.
Oh, that sounds like fun.
It is. It's a lot of fun.
And do you get to visit the penguins often?
I do. Actually, I was just in the aquarium's exhibit about a month ago, went in with another former colleague, and we spent the day in the penguin exhibit and also diving in the giant ocean tank. And the really cool thing is when I go, even 6 years later, they remember me.
The
and
penguins?
They do. They recognize me visually, and they also recognize the sound of my voice, which is how they recognize each other. And so as soon as they heard my voice, they came racing over across the exhibit, started greeting and braying and calling and honking. And so it's nice to be remembered by a penguin.
And on that note, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
That was so much fun.
Thank you.
Yeah, you sound like you're really enjoying what you do.
I am. I'm lucky.
Yeah, very. This is Spotlight Georgetown. Don't forget, Fridays, Saturdays, and Sundays, 8 a.m. and 8 p.m. And if you can do something for the wildlife and the penguins, take a look at it. Thank you for joining us. Bye for now.